This is the mandible. Generally, it is horseshoe-shaped bone or U-shaped bone. It has a body and perpendicular part, which is called the ramus of the mandible. So this is the body and the ramus of the mandible. There is an alveolar process that holds the mandibular teeth. In between the body and the ramus of the mandible is the angle of the mandible. Usually, the ramus of the mandible is perpendicular in the adult, but in the young, the angle is an obtuse angle. The ramus of the mandible is characterized superiorly by two processes. Here, anteriorly, is a flattened process, which is called the coronoid process of the mandible. And posteriorly, we have the condylar process. The condylar process has a head and a neck. Okay? And there is a fossa here, condylar fossa. The fossa, you can see the fossa here as well. This fossa provides for the attachment of the lateral pterygoid muscle. The lateral pterygoid is attached here as well as to the capsule of the temporomandibular joint. The coronoid process of the mandible, as well as the anterior border of the ramus of the mandible, they provide for the attachment of temporalis muscle. And in between the coronoid process and the condylar process, this is called the mandibular notch. Masseter muscle is attached here at the angle of the mandible from the outside. Immediately opposite to the attachment of masseter and on the inside of the angle of the mandible at this position is the attachment of the medial pterygoid muscle. So you can see here that the mandible provides for the attachment of all the muscles of mastication. Medial pterygoid here, lateral pterygoid here, temporalis here, and the masseter muscle here. The mandible develops in two halves, and these two halves, they fuse in the midline at about 2 years of age, at the what we call the symphysis menti in the midline, and become a single bone. Now this is half of a mandible. It has been cut in the middle. It's an adult mandible, not the mandible of the young, because as I mentioned, that the angle here between the body of the mandible and the ramus of the mandible is perpendicular, not obtuse, and you can see, of course, the development of the teeth. Here, this is the mental foramen, which transmits the mental nerve and vessels, and the mental foramen is usually, it is level with the second premolar tooth. This is the second premolar tooth here. These are the molar teeth. And you can see again the direction of the mental foramen. It is directed upwards and laterally. If we examine the internal aspect of the mandible, we can see here that in the ramus of the mandible, there is a foramen. This is called the mandibular foramen. What passes through the mandibular foramen is the inferior alveolar nerve and vessels. The inferior alveolar nerve, therefore, canalizes the mandible and supplies the teeth, and it sends a branch that appears on the skin, and this is the mental nerve. The branch passes through the mental foramen. And then the remaining part of the inferior alveolar nerve continues anteriorly within the canal. Again, you can see the mandibular foramen here, and the mandibular foramen is partially covered by a flange of bone here, which looks like a small tongue. It's called the lingula. And this lingula is, in fact, provides attachment for a ligament that extends from the spine of the sphenoid. The ligament is called the sphenomandibular ligament. The inferior alveolar nerve and vessels, before they enter into the mandibular foramen, they supply a branch, which is called the mylohyoid nerve. And this branch, you can see it here, whether the nerve or the vessel, you can see it, it grooves the bone behind the mandibular foramen. This is the inside of the neck of the mandible, and here the bone is closely related to auriculotemporal nerve, a branch of the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve, as well as It is also related to the maxillary artery. The mandible, behind the third molar tooth, and in this position here, is related to the lingual nerve, closely related to the lingual nerve, that might be injured in case of extraction of an impacted molar tooth. At the inferior border of the mandible and close to the midline, you can see here that there is a fossa or an impression. This is for the attachment of the anterior belly of digastric muscle. It is the digastric fossa. On the inner surface of the body of the mandible, you can see here that there is an oblique line. This is called the mylohyoid line for the attachment of mylohyoid muscle. The mylohyoid muscle is attached to this line on the mandible, and then inferiorly it is attached to the hyoid bone. Below the mylohyoid is the neck, and above the mylohyoid is the mouth. So the mylohyoid muscle is like a diaphragm between what is a neck below and what is a mouth above. Below the posterior end of the mylohyoid line, there is an impression or a fossa for the submandibular salivary gland. And above the anterior end of the mylohyoid line, there is another impression or fossa, smaller than this one. This is an oval, large impression. This is a smaller impression above the anterior end of the mylohyoid line. It is for the sublingual gland. And above the posterior end of the mylohyoid line, at this region, behind the third molar tooth, is the area that is related to the lingual nerve. Anteriorly, close to the midline, there are small tubercles, either one pair or two pairs of tubercles. These are called the genial tubercles, and they provide the attachment of genial muscles, geniohyoid and genioglossus.